First Corinthians 10. Verse 32. Somebody wants to read it there.
Give none offense neither to the Jews nor to the Gentiles nor to the church of God.
So you got three basic distinct groups of people identified in the Bible. You have the nation of Israel or the Jews. You have the Gentiles. And you have the church of God. Now, if anybody reads their Bible long enough, they're going to realize that over half of the Bible and its contents is about the nation of Israel. I mean, the whole Bible is a Jewish book with all Jewish writers. Moses, all the way up to the Apostle John on the Isle of Patmos, all of them were Jews. And the half of the Bible's contents being about Israel, it's about God's covenant with Israel, specific promises not given to any other nation that were only given to Israel. So the Old Testament is 100% Jewish. The other nations, if you go read your Bible and you read in the Old Testament, other nations aren't even mentioned or God's not even concerned with them unless it involves the nation of Israel.
Yeah.
I mean, God doesn't go off on these tangents in the Old Testament and start just talking about Russia and England and the Japhetic nations. He don't just go on tangents and start talking about the Hamites down in Africa. He doesn't do that. He focuses only on the nation of Israel and only talks about the other nations as it pertains to the nation of Israel and their dealings with the nation of Israel. You'll notice if you read your Bible long enough, we're going to look at some examples here when we start getting into the distinctions between Israel and the church. But you'll notice if you look in Deuteronomy 28 and 64, turn there with me. Deuteronomy 28. Verse 64. Bible says, "The Lord shall scatter thee among all people from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither now nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone." If you notice this, Israel's told that they're going to be scattered among all people. If you look at other scriptures, you'll see that Israel is an earthly people with earthly blessings and earthly cursings. Anytime they obeyed God in carnal things, I mean, they physically with their flesh and blood and their bodies went to the temple and they were obedient to God and offered the sacrifices that God told them to offer. If they obeyed physical commandments, they didn't lie with their mouth, they didn't kill with their hands, they didn't have feet that were swift to shed blood, and they did these physical, carnal, earthly things, then they received physical, carnal, earthly blessings. If they disobeyed God in those earthly, physical, carnal things, then they received earthly, physical, carnal cursings. God would scatter them physically amongst the earth.
All right.
So their blessings and their cursings were physical blessings and cursings. You'll see a lot when you get into the New Testament and you begin to see, like Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, that there's a wisdom of the world. That's the wisdom the Jew had. They had a worldly wisdom. They knew how to be blessed of God in worldly things by being obedient and all those things. But when you get in the New Testament, you start realizing, looking back at them, that they were spiritually blind and ignorant. Because they were earthly people with earthly blessings and earthly cursings. Even Jesus Christ, a Jew, the Bible says, was a blessing to who? All families of the earth. Jesus Christ is a physical blessing. Now to us in the church, he's a spiritual blessing. And we're going to get into that later through the new birth. Jesus Christ is a greater blessing to us, his body, than he is to earthly people.
Amen.
But through Abraham's seed, God called Abraham, and the promise of the Messiah, future promise of Messiah, Jesus Christ, was that he would be a blessing to all the families of the earth.
Yeah.
So when he comes back to reign, he is going to be a blessing to all families of the earth.
Amen.
There's going to be peace. No hunger. The whole earth is going to receive those earthly blessings of the Jews.
Good farming.
Yeah, good farming. It's like Paul said over in I forget where it's at, but Paul said in one place, he said, if the casting away of them be a blessing, Paul could probably quote this word for word, I'm not going to be able to, but if the casting away of them, we received a blessing, what shall the receiving of them be but salvation?
Life from the dead.
Life from the dead. So if Israel being cast away was the greatest blessing that we get as the church, then what's it going to mean for all the families of the earth when Israel is finally restored?
Amen.
You also notice in the Bible, if you read it and study it long enough, that the church is also distinct in Scripture. I mean, you go over there, the verse we just quoted, 1 Corinthians 10:32, gives you three distinct groups of people, and it ain't going to take you long. I can't stand when people reject that. When you quote that out of 1 Corinthians 10:32 and tell them that there's only three groups of people that God actually identifies in this earth, you're either a Jew, a Gentile, or you're a member of the body of Christ, and they reject it. But it don't take you long reading the Bible to notice that 1 Corinthians 10:32 is true. The Jew, the nation of Israel, is very distinct in Scripture.
Amen.
And the church is very distinct in Scripture. It's the only two groups of people in the Scripture that God devotes a whole lot of focus and time to. The church, just like Israel, also has a special relationship with God and specific promises from God. Just like Israel. Now we're going to look at some distinctions this morning between Israel and the church. Israel are the earthly descendants of who?
Abraham.
The church is there a distinction in Jew and Gentile in the church? In Christ, there's neither Jew nor Gentile.
Yep.
So Israel, to be considered a Jew, you must be an earthly descendant of Abraham.
Right.
I watch these people argue about the Zionism and all this stuff all the time. Hey man, if you don't know how to check DNA, just keep your mouth shut. God knows who his earthly descendants are.
Amen.
God will return them to the land when he's ready.
Amen.
God will restore that kingdom just like he said. He said in the book of Daniel, in the days of those kings, I will set up a kingdom.
Right.
God will. The UN's not going to set that kingdom up. I don't care how much money America sends over there. God don't need America's money.
That's right.
Look what he did. Look what he did to the Egyptians when they were in bondage down in Egypt. Did Israel have any money? Did they have anybody sending them money? No, God sent two men down there, struck them with a bunch of curses and signs and plagues, delivered his people, and guess what he told them to do when they left? He said, spoil your neighbor's goods, steal everything they have, because I want you to have everything they have when you leave. Israel's in a relationship with God through covenant. God made covenant with Abraham, but he also made a covenant with them as a nation when they came out of Egypt and met him at Mount Sinai. The church is in a birth relationship.
Amen.
We're in relationship with God because we're his sons. Dad can enter a covenant with his neighbor. He don't have to enter a covenant with me. Why? I'm his son. He can't break that relationship. He can be the worst dad on planet Earth. I'm still his son. I can be the worst son on planet Earth. I'm still his son. We will always have that relationship.
Amen.
Israel, through obedience, received earthly blessings. And wealth. Earthly blessings and wealth. What's the Christian told?
Suffer.
Be content with what? Food and raiment.
Yeah.
Obedience. Through obedience, the Christian is not promised earthly blessings and wealth. The Christian is told to be content with whatsoever things you have. And Jesus Christ said the only thing you really have need of is food and raiment. He didn't even have a home. We consider shelter to be a necessity a lot of times, and it's not. God can take care of you living out under a bush.
Right.
It shows you the difference right there, because under the Old Testament, gain was godliness. In the New Testament, Paul said anybody that supposes gain is godliness is men that have twisted minds.
Yeah.
Christian is promised contentment, persecution, and hatred. When Israel obeyed God, the other nations were in trouble.
Amen.
God would give them earthly blessings and the wealth of everybody around them. When the Christian obeys, if he's doing what he's supposed to do, he's going to be content, and he's going to suffer persecution and hatred. Why? No servant is greater than his master.
Right.
If the world hates you, know that it hated me first.
Amen.
He said. Israel was involved in temporal, earthly things. Church, supposed to have their mind set on spiritual heavenly things. Ephesians 4. God hath blessed us. Israel was blessed with temporal earthly blessings. The church is blessed with spiritual heavenly blessings. Ephesians 1:3, he hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ.
Amen.
Both of these groups of people had a beginning. Israel as a nation, the Jew didn't exist in Genesis chapters 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all the way up until about the middle part of Genesis when God calls out Abraham and tells him that he's going to make him a great nation. Which happens when Moses and Aaron leads them out of Egypt. Abraham's descendants. You see the beginnings of each group of people. This group in the call of Abraham, and this group, the church, if you look in Matthew 16:18, you got preachers all the time that want to group the Old Testament saints with the New Testament saints.
Yeah.
Say they're all the same group of people. And say that Adam and Abraham and all these people are members of the church. Has a bride ever been a guest at her own wedding?
No.
Guess what John the Baptist said? He said, I'm not the bride. I'm not the bridegroom, he said. He said, I'm the friend of the bridegroom. Guess what? We are the bridegroom. We're one with him.
Right.
Matthew 16:18, Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. Not, he has been building and will finish it. He said, I will build it. Future.
Right.
Yeah. That's good.
Ephesians 3:5-10. The church is not mentioned in Old Testament prophecy. Through the revelation of the New Testament, we can go back and find her. And see her hidden back there, tucked away back there,
amen,
in types and shadows,
hidden,
but she was not revealed.
Amen.
Ephesians 3:5-10, Paul says, which in other ages, speaking about the revelation that he had received, verse 2, the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given to me, how that he made, verse 3, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. He said, which, what, the mystery of Christ he's talking about. He says, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power, unto me who am less than the least of all saints is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Christ Jesus, to the intent that now, under the principalities and powers in heavenly places, might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God.
Amen.
So the church was hidden. If you want to write this down, the church is born in Acts chapter 2. It wasn't revealed yet what was going on. Peter and the other men, when you read Acts, they were receiving revelation as things happened. Just like the time they were preaching and the Holy Spirit fell on a bunch of men as they were listening.
Right.
They didn't come up before an old-fashioned altar. They didn't repeat a sinner's prayer. They were listening to the preaching of Peter, and they believed, and the Holy Spirit fell on them.
Amen.
Amen.
And what did the other ones do? They said, what does this mean? Why? Because they were a bunch of Gentiles that happened to.
Right.
And Peter and the rest of them said, what does this mean? I guess this means that they're going to receive the promise of the Spirit by faith the same as we are. So the church, it was still a mystery in that transition period in Acts, but it began in Acts chapter 2.
Yeah.
So the church begins in Acts 2. It retires on earth in 1 Thessalonians 4 at the rapture. It ain't finished, but its earthly dealings will be over with until she returns with Jesus Christ to reign. Now I want to look at some comparative positions of the Jew, the Gentile, and the church. Romans 9, 4 to 5. Speaking about the Jew, somebody read it.
Who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service of God and the promises, whose are the fathers and of whom is concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, God blessed forever. Amen.
Pertaining to Israel, you have the adoption, the glory, the covenants. Giving of the law. That's what Paul said. What advantage then hath the Jew? If circumcision doesn't matter much or doesn't amount to much, what advantage then has the Jew? He says much. In every way, chiefly because it was committed unto them the oracles of God. Service of God. You know, that Jew had a big responsibility.
Yeah.
How would you like to be responsible for going into God's presence and serving Him? If these waitresses and waiters think they got it bad out in Beckley, dealing with a bunch of grumpy customers and ain't never satisfied, how would you like to deal with a being trying to serve Him? I guarantee you, you can't satisfy Him.
Right.
Only one man ever did.
Amen.
The promises. The fathers, they had a hard time getting over that one too, didn't they?
Yeah.
John the Baptist called them out on it too. Remember that one? Say not in yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. Concerning the flesh, Christ came. John 4:22, the Gospel of John, chapter 4. Jesus says here, Jesus says, ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. Salvation is of the Jews. I mean, think about it. Christ came to them.
Yeah, he did.
Walked and talked with them. The gospel was preached to the Jew first.
Right.
And also to the Greek. Romans 3, 1 to 2.
What was it?
Romans 3, 1 to 2. What advantage then hath the Jew? For what profit is there of circumcision, much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God? They had the oracles of God. Everything about God that had been revealed up to the time of Christ was revealed to the Jew. They had a chief advantage over the other nations of the earth. They possessed, controlled, owned the oracles of God. I'm not going to write these down, but the Gentiles, here's their positions. It ain't good. Ephesians 2, 11 to 12 says they're aliens of Israel. They're strangers from the covenants of promise. The Gentiles are, they have no hope, and they're without God in the world. I think a lot of times as Christians, we've been saved so long, been involved in this thing so long, we fail to be grateful and appreciate what we have. But think about if that phrase still applied to you today, and that you was in this world without God and without hope.
Amen.
There's a lot of times in my life, the only thing that gets me by is just the simple fact that I have hope.
Amen.
Because of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Ephesians 4, 17 to 18 says the Gentiles walk in the vanity of the mind with darkened understanding. They're alienated from the life of God through ignorance because of the blindness of their own hearts. I tell people this all the time, not everybody's salvation experience is the same.
Right.
My earliest memories as a human being was right here in this church as a baby. I started kindergarten in this church, right in that room right there. Linda Aker was my teacher. Actually, my kindergarten class is back here where the office is now. I got good memory. So the revelation of God in my life has been a progressive thing from the time I was that big.
That's right.
I guarantee you Chuck Havert this morning can tell you what it's like when God shows himself to you and you get saved when you're in your 70s.
Amen.
I guarantee you he has a lot more understanding of Ephesians 4, 17 to 18 than a lot of us in here do this morning.
Yeah.
A time when you were without Christ, without hope, without God, you walked in the vanity of your mind, you had a darkened understanding, you were alienated from the life of God through ignorance because of a blind heart.
Amen.
Mark 7, 27 to 28 tells you that the Gentiles are dogs who shouldn't even have bread wasted on it. Ain't that what Jesus said? It's not meat to take the children's bread and cast it to dogs. Yeah. You know what the word meat means? It means necessary. It's not necessity. That means God of heaven has bread, and he doesn't think it necessary to take that bread and cast it to a Gentile dog.
Amen.
All right, here's some positions of the church. Ephesians 1, 22-23. I love this one. The body of Jesus Christ, who is the head of the body. But I want you to notice this. I've known this verse for a long time, and just last night this hit me. The extent of my understanding of this verse only extended to the fact that we are the body of Christ and he's the head. And my understanding of this verse extended to the understanding of eternal security, that we're one with him, by the flesh of his flesh, bone of his bone. This struck me last night looking at this verse. The Bible says there in Ephesians 1, 22-23, that the church, his body, is his fullness. We're talking about a man that went down to be baptized, and a voice came out of heaven and said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased." Jesus Christ said, "I do always those things that please the Father."
Amen.
When God said, "I want you to die for the sins of the whole world," he said, "Let this cup pass from me, but not my will, thy will be done." And he humbled himself and became obedient to God's will, even to the point of suffering death on a cross, the book of Philippians says.
Amen. Thank
you. And for this cause, God hath highly exalted him and given him a name above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord.
Amen.
To the glory of God. That man right there is the most highly exalted, wisest thing in God's entire wisdom.
Amen.
And the Bible says that a bunch of wretched sinners are his fullness. As if our Savior could be an empty glass without us.
Yeah.
If I was going to have a conversation with God based on my own wisdom, I'd tell him that idea made me consider he might just be a little insane. Y'all go ahead and look at me like I'm wicked for saying that. That seems insane to me.
Yeah.
That I could be considered the fullness of Jesus Christ. If anything, I should make him less full.
Amen.
It's not what we make him, it's what he makes us.
Ephesians 5:29-33. The church is members of his body. Flesh of his flesh, bone of his bone. We're one flesh. He loves us. As himself. Is that what he said, taught us there in chapter 5 of Ephesians? Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church. This is a great mystery. I speak concerning Christ and the church. The church owes reverence to him, just like the wife does her husband. We owe him reverence. I live in the body of sin and death just like everybody. But that means when he says pray without ceasing, we should desire and strive to pray without ceasing. Everything he asks us to do, we should have enough reverence. We owe him reverence. When's the last time we picked up our Bibles in our spare time? Instead of getting on the telephone, turning on the TV, or finding a hobby to do. 1 Peter 2:9 tells us the church is a chosen generation. Royal priesthood, holy nation. Peculiar people. Listen to this one. And we are to show forth praises to him, called by him out of darkness into his marvelous light. We're to show forth praises. You get a bunch of preachers together and somebody starts preaching on the book, and they get in a big shouting fit. You know what they're doing? They're showing forth praises.
Amen.
And then you got some that'll sit back and look at them with cross eyes.
Yeah.
And say, I just think it gets out of hand sometimes. They've never read the scenery in Revelation. We've been called out of darkness. Into his, not just light, his marvelous light.
At once, 5 minutes slow. I mean, off.
Yeah, I got about 10 minutes.
No, you got 20 minutes.
No, 10. We're in the 5 teal. All scripture concerning Israel and the church is contrast. We'll see that. We're probably not going to get much more of this morning. But when you read the distinctions and you notice the differences in the church and Israel, it's all contrast. From their origins to their calling to their promises to their worship to their principles of conduct and their future destiny. It's all contrast, but they're the same. Eye for eye, tooth for tooth. Then Jesus said, give place. If your enemy smites you, turn the other cheek. But they're all the same. The Jew had very little understanding in spiritual things. The Jew's understanding was physical. It was physical understanding from God. Solomon, the wisest man that ever lived, considered all things, what? Under the sun.
Yeah.
He was the wisest man to ever live, but you and I this morning are supposed to have a higher wisdom than even Solomon.
Amen.
Solomon looked at all the things under the sun. He said, this is right, that a man would enjoy the fruits of his labor. This is right. This is right. That's right. What? Under the sun, it's right.
Right.
But because under the sun, every man goes back to the dust, he said, it's all vanity.
Amen.
See, his understanding and his wisdom was limited to earthly understanding. All he could understand was is that when a man went back to the earth, it made everything else under the sun vanity. His wisdom didn't extend out past what happened after the man went back to the earth.
Nice.
The church understands that we, because God showed us, will receive rewards after we go into the earth for the things done in our bodies.
Right.
We have a higher wisdom. People argue about all this stuff in the earth. I mean, get you a few good Christian buddies and then be friends with them on Facebook. And watch them debate every political issue under the sun.
Yeah.
You know what I say? We have a higher wisdom.
Amen.
The Jew had very little understanding in spiritual things. His understanding was physical. Guess what? The Jew even gave us a physical book. They had physical understanding of blessings, no spiritual understanding of blessings. The church has spiritual understanding of blessings, but no promise of physical blessings. That's why the Jew required a sign. Exodus 15:26. Here's some contrast. Exodus 15:26. The Jew over there, 15:26. If they obey God, God tells them that he wouldn't send the diseases or the plagues that he sent on the Egyptians. See there? Physical promises of blessing. Physical healing if they obeyed. 2 Corinthians 12:5-9, however, for a Christian, Paul in the church age, Paul had the thorn in the flesh and he sought God 3 times to remove it. And God said, no, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Paul had a higher understanding than the Jews in the Old Testament that knew if they obeyed God, they'd receive physical healing. Paul knew if God's strength is made perfect in my weakness, then because of that higher spiritual understanding, he said, I will rather glory in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me.
Amen.
Higher wisdom. Write these scriptures down. You can compare them. Go home and compare them. 1 Corinthians 1:22. 1 Corinthians 14:21-22.
Shut up.
Mark 16:17-18. Acts 2:43. Acts 3. Acts 5:12-16. couple of quick points here and I'm going to close. I got 5 minutes. Why did God give them signs in the Old Testament? They didn't have this completed. That's why. God, how shall they know you sent me? Moses said. He said, because I'm going to give you some signs to prove that the God who's really in control of this thing is with you. Why? They didn't have a book. They couldn't walk by faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. They had to walk by sight. Why? They were earthly, physical people. So when you get in the New Testament, signs were always connected to the apostles. Or they were connected to people saved by the apostles, or people whose apostles' hands had been laid on. Mm-hmm. And guess what? Unbelieving Jews were always present. 2 Corinthians 12:12, Mark chapter 16, verse 20. Old Testament signs, because there was no Bible available. New Testament, the Bible's complete. So therefore, the New Testament Christian walks by faith, not by sight. There's nothing else to be revealed, folks. This Bible stands on its own.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
As the truth.
Right.
If you need a sign to back up this book and you got issues,
yeah,
it stands on its own.
Yes, it does.
Now notice this, and I'm done with this comment. The Bible says the Jew requireth a sign, but the Greeks seek after wisdom. Or the Gentiles. What are you this morning? The church, the Gentiles. This gives us wisdom.
Yeah.
Spiritual understanding.